Mohamed, we're very delighted to have you here. Yeah, and maybe you can start, please.
Yes, thank you so much for the introduction. And it's honestly a pleasure to take part of this beautiful energy that's being created. And I'm just honored to see also a lot of familiar faces, extremely happy to be able to be part of this. So from my side, my name is Mohamed Gabris. I come from Lebanon, a very interesting country nowadays with a lot of paradoxes and uprising issues. I've been a volunteer with initiatives of change since 2013, more or less, and I was mainly volunteering and working under the scope of initiatives of change India. That was mainly my major commitment. And it was an incredible, incredible journey of being with initiatives of change and going through all of these processes of reflection and introspection and inner healing, and then hoping and aiming to always pass this knowledge over and pass this healing over and transforming this asset into an actionable impact that influences and changes lives and individuals around us. Briefly about myself, since 2015, I've been involved in working with the humanitarian sector in Lebanon, working with national and international organizations on mainstreaming accountability and protection against sexual abuse and exploitation within the humanitarian sector. So the notion of protection and safeguarding. I'll be sharing briefly the thinking process that I had when I was requested to design something or to share something on the lines of igniting action. Something that I relate to a lot and something that a lot of other members have participated with different various IFC initiatives, whether in co-Switzerland, whether in India and Sri Lanka and other parts of the world, we all have been touched in one way or another, and we've witnessed and experienced that sense of healing and that sense of transformation, starting with these little steps, starting with giving some time to inner silence and giving that time of redirecting our lives through putting things right in our lives. That was an incredible journey. It was overwhelming. It wasn't easy at all. But something that we all shared in common, and of course it was a rewarding experience, the end result of it. So something that we all shared in common is that what's next? Once we go back to our countries, once we go back to our homes, to our comfort spaces, our comfort zones, once this conference is over and having all these enriching conversations that impacted us and influenced us from within in one way or another, what's next? Where do we go there now from there? And that was a major concern for myself and a lot of other initiators and interns in IFC India and IFC Switzerland. And from there, I was doing my best to put everything that I've experienced in words into how my personal experience and how my personal sharing and how my personal healing journey was translated into action, at least on my scope of perception and at least in my situation. And I hope that what I would be sharing might be useful for others, at least mind triggering in one way or another. And I would really pray that this would be also of an added value to your time and to your attendance today with us with this workshop. So to begin with, something that I thought of initially thinking about this phase of transition from healing to action and this sense of questioning what's next and how can I translate and transfer this energy, this feeling from within outwardly, and how can I invest this creative energy anyway. A concept that was, if I'm not mistaken, was mentioned during the conference briefly, which is the notion of connection, correction, and direction. And what I'll be focusing on today and shedding more light on is the direction aspect. We had some time with ourselves, we connected with who we once were and who we are becoming in the process. We did identify some aspects in our lives that requested our attention and that requested our healing, things to be amended in our lives, something that would help us actualize our purpose, or what is it that we are meant to be doing in life. And then comes the aspect of correction, putting things right in my life, whether it being changing certain habits or attributes, or putting certain relationships right in my life, or setting things right in any kind of sense that it might make for you. And then the aspect of direction, which I'll be diving deeper into it today. So the first thing, the first step for me is this sense of confusion, that phase of confusion. And this question that always comes to my mind and to a lot of my fellow initiators, that where do I start from? And it's an overwhelming feeling of gratitude, an overwhelming feeling of release, of healing, of challenges, of fears, of insecurities at the same time. Of course, they never disappear. And this willingness within us, wanting to start from a place, somewhere, somehow. So the first thing for me, and where to start from, the first thing that I thought of is setting intentions. And I truly believe that what guides us in our lives and what guides our actions in life and what's being translated to the world out there is our intentions. There are two beautiful quotes that I wish to share with you that has inspired me a lot throughout the years. Is that, first of all, looking at intention is at it being more than a wishful thinking, it's a willful direction. So for me, whenever I'm thinking of what is it that I'm intending to do in life, what is it that I'm intending, how am I intending to utilize my life, my skills, my talents, my strengths, my weaknesses, and how am I going to contribute to the larger picture, per se. Another quote that says setting an intention is the initiation and the first step into your preferred story. And for me, this is something really empowering. The idea that I am in control of my destiny and in control of how I choose to shape my story. Of course, I'm not in control of the circumstances, but at least I'm in control of the way I engage and I interact with these circumstances. So the first thing I was thinking, okay, how am I going to transfer this knowledge? Where to begin with in terms of setting these intentions? The first thing that I thought of is reflection, reflecting some more and spending time with ourselves and asking these difficult questions. What is it that I would need from life? Am I happy in the situation that I'm currently in now? Am I happy with this given job, with this given path that I'm taking? Am I happy with the engagement, sense of engagement or level of engagement that I'm having with people around me? So on and so forth. And then what I thought of to simplify it more is to start with keywords. So for me, thinking after coming back from India and from this incredible experience, the keywords that were popping to my head are healing, transfer knowledge, for example, ethical leadership, contributing to other people's journeys and healings. A lot of big words, and I didn't quite know how to shape these and how to make sense of it and how to turn these intentions and these words into something that's actionable. So the first thing that I started is thinking of these keywords that meant something to me, and it can be reflected through the things that I would value in my life. Write it down, do brainstorm it, jot all of these keywords down, create a theme, because often these words are linked and connected. So try to find this connection and this link with these words, jot it down, revisit it on a regular basis after having established that theme. Because as you know, circumstances changes, our values changes, our priorities do change, especially with the forever changing world that we're going through now and the huge level of uncertainty that we're all living in across all parts of the world. And then to repeat the process, to reflect some more, to continue on thinking of the keywords, to continue on writing down and trying to make sense of that theme and to visit that on a regular basis, just that when we are satisfied with it, then to have this as an intention set for ourselves and for our lives. And a simple equation that I placed here is that for me, intentions are the door for setting your goals, and intentions are the pathway to achieve these goals. It's having that sense of direction. And why am I doing what I'm doing currently? Is it just for the sake of attaining materialistic concerns in my life, which is not wrong? I mean, it could be a value. Is it for me contributing to the issues and the troubles of the world? Is it me coming up with something so creative and artistic and to offer it to the world for the world to enjoy it? Or is it to entertain others? And if that sits quite well with me and gives me that sense of satisfaction, then this is the intention that I would abide with and flow with. The second thing that I thought of, so the first thing is setting my intention and then starting with small, slow steps. Because often I remember when we used to finish all these phases of the internship program of any initiative of a certain conference that we used to participate in, we would come together and be like, yeah, let's do something. Let's create some certain workshops and raise awareness on these topics and these notions. Let's create a certain, a small movement in my village, for example, for waste management or empowering youth, or I don't know what can be a scale of various initiatives and projects that one can think of. And often it gets extremely overwhelming. If it's possible to mute. Yeah, thank you so much. Okay. And then after having all these thinking processes, we get often overwhelmed and it's too big of a task and there's no way I'll be able to achieve it. And we're always thinking of the end goal, not knowing that these huge journeys, they start with small little steps. So I would like to quote Mark Twain when he said that the secret of getting ahead is getting started, and the secret of getting started is breaking your complex, overwhelming tasks into small, manageable tasks and starting on the first one. So taking that, initiating that one first step, no matter how complex the bigger picture might be, just break it down and see what step can I be taking today. And just like the grains of sand, one grain at a time, there you go, you have an ocean or you have a desert in a way, something incredible and marvelous and something tangible, an environment that we hope to create for our lives. The third concept that I thought of when it comes to igniting action is accepting the reality that I'm going to fail and that I'm going to be hitting walls the whole time. And it's not going to be a fun journey. I'm going to lose hope as I move forward. I'm going to give up on a lot of things. Finances could be an obstacle. COVID could be an obstacle. Family commitments, priorities, my full-time job. A lot of things could be an obstacle. And I might face a lot of different challenges and it just would make me want to quit. So to ease this process up, what I thought of reflecting on my personal life and what got me and led me to living what I've always hoped to live and being in the space that I always prayed to be is looking at these challenges and failures and dead ends as opportunities and lessons and a sense of redirection to a new path. What do I mean by that is that in a way, letting go of the expectations that I have of how my path should look like and how my next step should look like. And often by failing and by facing certain challenges, I look at it as sometimes a message of being redirected into doing things in a different way or redirected to a completely new path. And I was thinking I was having a discussion with a friend of mine when I was walking with him through the flow of my thoughts and to have someone to consult with. What I thought of and what we were inspired by is that opportunities often they don't have to be sugar-coated the whole time. Whenever we think of the word, oh, there's an opportunity for me to ignite that action or for me to take these steps, we think that it's a pleasant one. It's an open door with roses, with petals of roses across the path and clarity on where I'm going. Often opportunities are masked with challenges, with pain, with frustration and with a lot of different various hardships that most of us are subjected to and are vulnerable to. Allowing a space for pleasure in facing these challenges. I mean, I'm not sure to what extent that would make sense for some, but it's something that I've personally experienced in some certain circumstances. These challenges, they genuinely brought pleasure. It was like a lot of signs that God has been given through these challenges and redirecting me and forcing me to reflect in a way that this challenge is a reflection of whatever that's happening within me. And it was always being redirected to look within. Is there any kind of maintenance that I need to work on as I'm moving towards my journey? So accepting this phase of failing and hitting walls, and it's not gonna be an easy phase at all. The other step, I promise I'm almost done, and I'll be giving you some reflective questions and a lot of space for all of us to share and to connect with one another. I wish I can see all of you in person and be able to connect with all of you and take all sorts of sharings and questions, but due to the limited time, I'll be doing my best to give you some time for the breakout rooms. Persistence in action, it's extremely important. Often we think that it's a sequential thing. So for me to achieve and fulfill whatever that I'm hoping to fulfill, it's these five steps. And whenever I'm done with these five steps, I'll be like, oh, I'm done, but I still feel empty. I'm not satisfied. I need to go on to the next one. But sometimes there's magic and there's value in being persistent in the same action and going back to that intention. Are my actions being in line with the intention that I've set? And there's another quote, I'm a big fan of quotes, that also spoke to me throughout the years. And it was a quote that I read it in AP. And I used it in one of my drawings that I displayed in AP and Initiatives of Change India. It says, consistency is the key to success. Your thoughts become your words, coming from the sense of intention. Your words become your actions, following these little rhythms of little steps to take. Your actions become your habits become your character, and your character determines your destiny and gives you that sense of direction on where I should be going next. And when I think of persistence in action, I can't not talk about determination, reminding yourself and myself that why we're doing what we're doing. And am I always satisfied with what I'm doing currently? Creating a discipline or a sense of routine, which is something extremely important because often mountains and rivers are not in a way shaped with a single drop of water. It's shaped with thousands of drops of water flowing over years and years and years. So this discipline or routine creates something so tangible and everlasting with a sustainable impact and effect. Okay, I'm just giving a chance to go through the messages in the chat box in case there was any kind of questions. Please feel free if you have, you know what, I'm gonna pause for now. If there's any questions or any reflections so far before continuing, please feel free to unmute yourself and go ahead. I'll give 5 minutes for doing so. Going once and going twice, and I think I'm gonna continue. Okay. The other thing that I thought of as well, and it was mentioned briefly when I joined the workshop just before mine, and I was just extremely happy that what I was thinking was in line with what was already discussed. So connections and building bridges. For me, sometimes when I got back from India to Lebanon, I went through 4 months of extreme depression, and it was so hard. I felt that nobody was able to understand my language, and nobody was able to grasp and to have that feeling of what I felt, that inner journey, that inner healing, how powerful that is. I felt like, guys, like I have answers. Like, please ask me. Let's do something about it. Let's create something about it. Then I realized that if I didn't work on, in a way, doing my best to reach out to others and to connect and to communicate, it's so hard to do it on my own. And I did find a lot of strength in building connections and reaching out to others and in finding people who are similar to me in a way, who share same values or similar values, who share same visions and same intentions and same purposes. And that was extremely empowering. And another quote that I also love the most is that it's according to Carl Jung, an old alchemist gave the following consolation to one of his disciples, yani student, one of his students. No matter how isolated you are and how lonely you feel, if you do your work truly and accountably, if I am committed and in belief, and I truly have faith in that purpose and in that intention, unknown friends will come and seek you. And that's exactly what happened. And out of nowhere, in random discussions and random conversations and random social settings, I'll be connected with people and having random informal chit chats that literally has shaped my life and that literally led me through certain directions. And when I look back, I know, it all makes sense. And it's all connected to my intention. And I always thought, and if my life didn't go as per my expectations, meaning that I'm failing, only to know that what I expected, the actions or the state that I expected myself to be in life was not the reality that I had, was not the what the universe has given me. But at the end of at the end of the day, what the universe has given me, which wasn't my expectation, fulfilled my intention and fulfilled my purpose. And I was redirected in a way. I had exactly the same intention, and the universe responded in its own language, with its own path, by being in the current position that I'm currently in, being able to support and to contribute to vulnerable people and contributing to that sense of protection to migrants and immigrant workers and to refugees and to vulnerable Lebanese in Lebanon, and ensuring that they are protected from any kind of abuse or exploitation, and ensuring that organizations are accountable. And I mean, these are all values that I've learned and that I've gained and that my soul was enriched with IFC. And I always thought that the only way forward is to be just like Frank Buchman, and to be with a group of people reaching out and facilitating workshops and sessions and talking about inner governance and talking about inner silence. And I tried doing that, but it didn't work to my community, and it didn't work with my people. And then the universe gave me other tools and other spaces to translate that intention that I had in mind and that I had in my heart. And everything that I gained with initiatives of change was translated in a way that I didn't even expect it to be. I'm talking a lot, I promise I'll be done very soon. The final thing, and that's my favorite, is just having some faith and trust. I mean, sometimes things might not go as we expect them to be, and things might be extremely confusing. And okay, Mohamed, great words, great flow, they're clear. But for me now, currently, they're not applicable. I mean, I have the intention, but I don't know where to start from. I have the intention, but I mean, if you'd look at my financial situation or my family situation or my priorities, I'm literally chained. There's nothing that I can do. And I have no answer to that. I have no tool. I have no insight for that, except to say it's really important just to have some faith and trust. It's something that I cannot translate. It's something that I can only feel. And to have trust in this uncertainty and to say, you know what, God, you know what, universe, you're my friend. In a sense, I know that I'm being taken care of. I mean, that I've been born here for a purpose, and you've been sending me all these incredible people, all these incredible circumstances, all these incredible, incredible signs for a purpose, for a reason. So for me, accepting the fact that things might go against your expectations, and that's okay. Allowing things to happen at their own pace. Sometimes we might be in an extreme rush and not being able or not knowing when things are going to start or when things are going to end. But sometimes we need to allow things to happen at their own pace, and to believe and trust that there's a meaning behind most things. I'm not going to say all things, because some people might say, well, I had a great loss in my life and I can't see the meaning. Of course, I'm not here at all to try and label your pain. And what I would say is just have faith and have some trust in the process. And I'm sure you'll figure something out on your own pace and with your own journey. And to just go with the flow of the current instead of fighting the current and going against the current and the current of life. And sometimes, as I said, we are being redirected into some other things in life, but it's very important to have that intention in front of me and to remind myself, okay, Mohamed, today, what is it that I'm meant to be doing? To remind myself, who am I? What values do I live up to? And I swear to you, the most little things, you'd find purpose by speaking to a complete stranger on the street, or by just smiling to a random kid on the street, and you never know what impact that might give. And I'm just giving silly examples, but I hope you would get the gist of it. I'm gonna pause here before going to the reflective questions, and I would love to hear from you. If you have any sharings or any questions or any reflections that you'd like to contribute to the space, and I'm just extremely looking forward to hear from you. Thank you so much, you guys, for the beautiful comments. I was just scanning them if there's any kind of questions. There's something, a comment that really inspired me to share something with you. For me, there's purpose in every day and in every phase of our life. I would love to share that I've been struggling with intense anxiety for the past year or so. I never experienced that in my life, and I never knew that it was so painful to the extent that I feared losing myself, and I feared losing my life at a certain point. And everything just darkened. And it was during the COVID situation, the economic collapse, checking my Instagram. I don't know what's happening in Palestine. There's an earthquake in the Philippines. There's a plane crash there. There's an economic crash there. Sri Lanka is on fire. Ukraine is on fire. I don't know what's happening with the people in Russia. I don't know what's happening in Latin America. Every single corner of the world was booming with negativity and was booming with a lot of insecurities and fears and distresses. And that triggered a lot my anxiety and made me question, what is it that I'm doing? What is it that I'm contributing to life? And I lost faith and I lost trust in my flow and the intention that I had to myself and that I set to my life. And I was doing exactly what I wanted to do. I mean, I was working in the humanitarian sector, I was contributing, but then I felt that it was meaningless. And through that phase, I was able to seek others just to get to know that others were going through exactly the same phase as I was going, that we were all sailing in the same boat, and we created that beautiful support system to one another. I started thinking about, and what is it that I can do now to do things differently? And I thought of myself, okay, let's check if I can see a therapist. And indeed, it worked wonders, and it helped a lot. And that, in a way, in anchoring that sense of healing and that journey of healing that was ignited by initiatives of change and with initiatives of change throughout my journey in India and Switzerland. And also, it was an inspiration just being able to see the purpose behind all this pain and all this anxiety, only to strengthen my belief and my intention and to reshape the way I was looking at things. And just opportunities started emerging out of nowhere, and spaces started opening out of nowhere, and emails started being flooded that we need support and mainstreaming protection in this organization, and we need support and ensuring that there's an accountability mechanism in this organization, and we want to ensure that there's an awareness raising session to empower this affected population and to strengthen and to empower their sense of dignity and safety. So just briefly to share that with you, and it was a very decent phase, and that we're all subjected to these ups and downs as we move forward. And remember, it's always important to remind ourselves of what's my intention and to have that sense of faith and trust. Dr. Najia, hi. I hope you're keeping well, and so happy to see your face after a very long time.
Yes, me too, ya Muhammad. Thank you very much. I enjoyed very much your sharing. God bless you. And the last sentence you shared, go with the flow of the current, reminded me that my father, who passed away 21 years ago, whenever I felt stressed and overwhelmed, he would tell me, Nagi, aumi ala dahrik, swim on your back. You know that feeling when you are lying on the water and letting the water carry you? Right now, I'm going through a very difficult test with a project that we had started in Egypt, since 2005, and it's already built and part of it furnished and finished, and we are threatened to lose everything now. It's putting us in a very, tough situation. But again, I remembered, there is a verse in the Bible that says, all things work together for good for them that love God, for them that are the called according to his purpose. And in the Holy Quran, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَخَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَشَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that you may like something and it's bad for you, or you may dislike something when it's good for you. And I feel I have to trust in God, and that he has the answer, and that one of my friends says that God works in mysterious ways, wondrous are his miracles. So I trust that we will emerge from the situation we are facing now, and that things will go in the right way. I hope so. Pray for us. Thank you very much, Muhammad. God bless.
I mean, thank you so much, Dr. Nagia, and a lot of love and prayers flowing your way. I mean, as you said, that in hopes things will miraculously change. Maria del Coral, you had a question.
Hi, hello, Mohamed. Thank you so much for your sharing. I am truly moved and I'm so grateful that we can be in this international community. And I identify with everything that you've said. I've gone through depression, through anxiety, the whole thing. Colombia is a very difficult country with lots of violence. And I agree with Dr. Nadia that we need to swim on our backs and trust. And what I found is that you never know what's going to happen and you never know, you have no control. So it's best to get used to not having any control and not knowing. It's like living in the not knowing is much better than trying to live in the knowing. And life is an adventure. And it's a wonderful adventure. And all the things that seem so dark actually bring light almost always, which is an amazing discovery for me. I am an artist. And one parallel that I can do with art is if you don't have light colors, you cannot see the dark colors and vice versa. You can't see darkness if you don't see light. So there are two faces of the same experience. So we need to go through the darkness. We need to do that. And another thing I want to contribute is there's an American sociologist, which I read and listened to in talks, Brené Brown. And she says, we humans unite through vulnerability, which is wonderful to me. I mean, we don't link to each other by showing our strengths. We link to each other by showing our weaknesses, our vulnerability, our difficulties. And that is how we connect. So it's wonderful what you've shared. And I can identify with everything that you've said. I'm 65 and I still don't know where I'm going. And I don't think I will ever know where I'm going because this is like a river. You don't know what the next turn of the river is going to show you. So I just get used to the difficulty and I enjoy the scenery. And as Dr. Nadia said so wisely, I try to swim on my back every once in a while, you know. So thank you so much. I feel very connected. I feel very identified. We are one community. We are one world. And just thank you. I'm very grateful.
Thank you so much, Maria, for your beautiful contribution. If I may share something, a metaphorical and a literal example about light emerges from the darkness. I was just sharing with an expat friend of mine who lives here. She's from France. And she was like, hi, Mohamed, how's everything? Just a quick chit chat before the meeting. And I was like, I'm just so extremely frustrated. I mean, nothing is going well in this country. We're currently living with no electricity, by the way, if for the ones who don't know, there's a complete absence of the government. Its organizations, national and international, and civil societies are the ones taking a lot of initiatives and action points. And she was like, but Mohamed, I think it's a very positive outlook to it. And I was like, how come? And she gave me an insight, which she reminded me, and sometimes we need to take a step backward and look at things from a balcony view. So in the south of Lebanon, for example, and many other parts of Lebanon as well, where there is no electricity, a lot of people started resorting to solar panels and solar energy and having this clear energy and being completely independent than any kind of fuel related source of energy. And that was something incredibly inspiring that they took this challenge, they took this difficulty, they took this dependency on this natural resource, and they transformed this into something that the whole world aspires to. Yeah, just felt inspired to share this. And the space is open again for any questions or remarks, please feel free.
I don't have questions, Mohamed. It's just my heart is overjoying to see you again. It's Charles. I tremble at what you go through in Lebanon and that you somehow keep going. And it's such a great joy to see you again, friend.
So happy to see you as well, Charles.
And I remember times in your parents' home and in Beirut and, of course, in Panjgani and maybe other places too. So anyway, you're still painting? Because Maria said she paints, but I know you paint and your brother is an artist and so on.
I think my whole energy was redirected into dealing with my anxiety and overthinking. So I didn't touch any kind of form of art for the past 8 months or so. But yeah, I mean, I was working artistically from within. So it's a painting for me. Yeah. Thank you so much, Charles. So good to see you as well. Yeah, and the notion of overthinking, I mean, with my therapist, my main issue was overthinking because I was overfeeling, overacting, and overthinking, and hence a perfect recipe for anxiety. And the only way to deal with overthinking is to face these thoughts and to go head in head with these fears. For example, thinking of a romantic relationship, is my partner cheating on me? Is my partner being loyal? Am I going to lose my job? Did this person think of me that way? Are these people looking at me this way? Is that insecurity obvious to everyone? And just by facing and talking about it and communicating, it literally just calmed my overthinking a lot, and a lot of herbal tea as well. Yeah. Okay, so moving forward and utilizing the last perhaps 15 minutes of our time, if we can take 5 minutes to reflect on the following questions, and then perhaps we can spend 15 minutes in breakout rooms and spend more time on sharing. So the two questions that I thought of, and please don't limit your sharing to these two questions, of course, feel free to explore and dig deeper. What's your intention in life, and what's your intention behind your living? Think of the keywords or the themes as we spoke about, and of what speaks to you and what gives you that push every day that my life is worth living and that I'm contributing in one way or another, if it was it being to one individual or to a group of people. And the second question that I thought of that I would like to invite everyone also to reflect upon is that, is there anything stopping you from fulfilling your intention? If so, what is it that you can do about it today? I would love to add the word today. So two questions: what's your intention in life, and what's your intention behind your living? Start thinking about keywords or themes. And is there anything stopping you from fulfilling your intentions? If so, what is it that you can do about it today? And of course, give some space to think about any other thoughts or insights that you'd like to share. So Sidra, if we can take 5 minutes of reflection, and then we can automatically disperse into our breakout.